Chalni.
Thank you, Dr. Reena. Good morning, everyone. At the outset, I would thank Dr. Meenakshi for giving me this opportunity to talk about secondary glaucoma and miscellaneous situations and systemic diseases. Let's see this interesting case of 50-year-old female who was diagnosed with glaucoma.
Is not coming. Your slides,
slides, please.
Are there any questions to any of the speakers?
Yeah. Okay.
No, it's ready. Okay.
So, this is a 50-year-old female patient who was diagnosed with glaucoma 1 year ago, and she had a well-controlled IOP on one drug. Past ocular history was nothing significant. She was on medical history, medical treatment on hypertension. There was no family history. Now, recently she got an inferior arcuate scotoma, and that is why she was referred to us for the management. We checked the intraocular pressure was 18 and 16 with normal Dahlner curve. BCVA was also normal. She had open angles on gonioscopy. Disc was showing classical glaucometer's defect with reproducible fields on second examination also. So in such a scenario where pressures are controlled and the defects are appearing, we need to think in other collateral ways also. So we thought of asking retrospective history of snoring and assuming that there might be sleep apnea, but it was not there. So we did a 24-hour Dahlner 24-hour blood pressure monitoring, and what we found was that there was a nocturnal hypotension happening, and at early morning around 4 o'clock the blood pressure recorded was 70 to 56 millimeters of mercury. So here the thing is that there are so many systemic diseases which are associated with glaucoma, and this was a study in published in Survey of Ophthalmology where the systemic hypertension topped the list. Besides this, hypercholesterolemia, diabetes, cardiac disease, they all can actually predispose or can be a risk factor for glaucoma. Not just the diseases, actually the associated medications which are being taken for these diseases can also interact, producing either a high IOP or causing more of systemic side effects for that particular drug. So hypertension, we just saw that can lead to nocturnal hypotension, and this has been seen in various Baltimore survey and Egna-Newmark study also. When we are talking of the medications, what these hypertensive patients are taking, it is important to consider that if the patient is already on oral beta blockers and we are adding topical beta blockers for glaucoma, the IOP control not be that significant in such patients. So we must consider some other medications. Moreover, if you are adding systemic medications on topical beta blockers, the side effects, they actually multiply. So we should avoid doing this. Secondly, these patients are quite likely to be on diuretics. So sometimes diuretics, they predispose to acute primary angle closure glaucoma due to forward shift of iris lens diaphragm. Sometimes the diuresis, they induce actually cause electrolyte imbalance, and if we are giving carbonic anhydrase inhibitor, they can potentiate the problem. Similarly, if they are on calcium channel blockers, if a patient is of glaucoma, we prefer peripheral calcium channel blockers because centrally acting can potentiate the cardiac side effects. So these things we should consider while giving the medications to our hypertensive patients. Now let's see the cardiac patients. Cardiac patients per se do not have any glaucoma association, but the drugs they are using are important to assess, because if patient is on anticoagulants like aspirin or warfarin, It has been shown to produce bilateral angle closure glaucoma, and the case reports are also there to substantiate the same. Similarly, if the patient is using digoxin, which is the cardiac glycoside, they can actually increase, if we add beta blockers, they can actually increase the concentration of digoxin producing the toxicity. So if the patient is on beta blocker, we should monitor the digoxin levels very meticulously. Now let's see diabetes. The role is controversial. Also, the risk found with diabetes of glaucoma is almost the double. Neovascular glaucoma, we know, is associated with PDR. Now, whenever patient is on anti-hypoglycemic drug, we need to be careful because adrenergic agonists, if added, they can decrease the effect of insulin producing hyperglycemia. Therefore, we need to be careful. Similarly, systemic carbonic anhydrase inhibitors, they produce hypokalemia that can actually raise the levels of blood sugar in patients of diabetes. And glycerol, we all know that oral hyperosmotic agent can lead to hyperglycemia and therefore is contraindicated. Now coming to another case scenario of 22-year female patient. She was using spectacles for past 12 years and very comfortably doing her routine works when suddenly she came to us with headache, nausea, vomiting, and sudden loss of vision for past one day. So we examined, she was highly uncooperative for the examination. Best corrected visual acuity was hand movement in both the eyes, and she was severely photophobic, not opening her eyes. So on slit lamp examination, what we saw that there was bilateral circumciliary congestion with corneal edema, extremely shallow anterior chamber, mid-dilated pupils, and IOP of 43 and 48 millimeters of mercury, although we had tough time taking the intraocular pressure. So in such a scenario, bilateral acute angle closure glaucoma, the diagnosis was made. So what was the course of action? As just now we saw in Dr. Manoj's presentation, sometimes we need to take retrospective history of medication which patient might have taken. She was advised topiramate which for the migraine. So sometimes migraine per se might not be associated, but the medications which patient is using for these problems can precipitate to bilateral acute angle closure glaucoma. So these are the list. I won't go into detail. We already saw a nice presentation on this. Now coming to case scenario of a 55-year-old male patient who was under glaucoma treatment for glaucoma for past 5 years. He was on 3 anti-glaucoma medication and systemic diseases. He had controlled diabetes and family history was nothing significant. Now what happened was there was a progression of field and therefore he was referred to us. Now in past treatment history, what we saw that baseline IOP was 36 and 32 millimeters of mercury with 3 anti-glaucoma medication, but pressures were very well controlled throughout the follow-up period. On examination, best corrected visual acuity was 618 and 66, pressures were controlled, gonioscopy showed open angle, and this showed classical glaucometer cupping, and right eye showed advanced glaucometer cup. So we reviewed the fields available with the patient. What we saw was that there was a superior arcuate scotoma which actually progressed to advanced defect in the third field. And for left eye, which was initially normal, a few depressed spots were there in the inferior part of the field, which actually progressed to almost forming sort of inferior arcuate scotoma. So definitely there was progression, diurnal pressures were well controlled. So again, what should be the course of action in such scenario? So there was no hypertension, diabetes mellitus was well controlled on medication. So we asked about any dermatological illness or bronchial asthma for which he might be taking steroids, but as such there was no history. So again we scratched our mind and we thought of asking about occupation. So now here there was a click that he was a priest in the temple and he was blowing conch shells twice daily when the aarti was being chanted. So continuously he was blowing shang. So we thought, is it the problem? And we reviewed the literature and we found interesting studies which showed that whenever there are these instruments which actually require blowing, they might raise the intraocular pressure. So because of Valsalva maneuver. So we did Valsalva in our patient, the IOP rose from 14 to 18 millimeters of mercury. We also thought of doing ocular blood flow in such scenario, and what we found was that the ocular blood flow actually went down, peak systolic velocity and end diastolic velocity went down when the patient was doing Valsalva maneuver, and this was happening in all the three arteries, central retinal artery, ophthalmic artery and short posterior ciliary arteries. So here it was the occupation which was the main culprit, and we asked the patient to not to blow the conch shell. So that way, by thinking collaterally, we can actually think different causes of glaucoma or progression which is happening in our patient, and then we can advise to our patient in such a way. So to conclude, I would say that we need to be very observant whenever the patient of glaucoma is progressing despite controlled intraocular pressure. We can think about sleep apnea, atrial fibrillation, vasospasm, systemic hypotension. We need to do 24-hour blood pressure monitoring. We also should ask the patient that at what time of day the patients are taking their blood pressure medication. If they are taking at bedtime, we need to, in consultation with the internist, we can ask them to shift their medication to morning times. We should consider sleep lab testing for apnea whenever required. We can also check high homocysteine levels, which can be easily treated. And then we need to check concomitant medications which patients are taking to avoid any interaction and side effects. Thank you so much for your kind attention.